Working hundreds of meters above water with components longer than an A380 wingspan and heavier than a steam engine, engineers building the latest generation of wind turbines routinely overcome head-spinning obstacles. Is it really wobbly up there? Do some turbines actually float? Join us today as we fanboy out and discover how wind turbines are assembled. The first ever offshore wind farm, Vindeby in Denmark, came on stream just 30 years ago. It was, you might say, revolutionary. Since then, this utopian technology has gone from strength to strength, with taller turbines and ever more extensive wind farms. Some turbines, of course, are land-based, others are all at sea. Today, we'll try and consider both, starting at the bottom and working up. Onshore turbines typically sit on great concrete foundations. These foundations can take many forms, depending on the nature of the site. For instance, this so-called shallow mat extension, which is essentially a gigantic disc of reinforced concrete. It's not terribly environmentally friendly and needs a lot of excavating, but it's strong and versatile. Alternatively, a ribbed beam foundation format is more structurally elegant, uses fewer materials, but is more complex and therefore tricky to pull off. Another foundation technique, uplift anchors, incorporate pre-stressed metal hooks that rely on the strength of surrounding rocks to prop up the mighty turbine. But of course, this is only useful in certain geological contexts. On sites where soil stiffness is an issue, long metal geopiers, perhaps 100 per turbine, burrow deep into the earth. Fundamentally, the job of the base is to overcome what engineers call the overturning moment. This is a fancy way of saying they stop it from toppling over. Offshore turbines come in two flavors, floating and rooted. Floating turbines, usually in either the spar buoy or semi-submersible varieties, literally sit on floating bases. These are boats, more or less, which are anchored to the seabed using long, sturdy steel ropes. Floating turbines aren't perfect, but they cause less disruption to marine ecosystems than their rooted alternative, which currently involves drilling gigantic 80-meter, 1,000-ton steel cylinders called monopiles deep into the seabed. This process, employing gigantic hydraulic hammers, has been recorded making a 210-decibel racket underwater, causing great distress to local seals and porpoises. Getting these monopiles out to sea at all requires a veritable armada of boats, from humble tugs to almighty dedicated sea-jacking ships, which raise themselves clean out of the water to provide a stable working platform. Once the monopile, a colossal steel rod in effect, is rooted in the seabed, a transitional piece is affixed to the top. This transitional piece is in itself up to 30 meters long, and is typically brightly colored to make the attached boat mooring stage visible in bad weather. One very important job of the transitional piece, after being mated to the monopile and stuffed with cement grout, is to level out the tip of the monopile in order to help the turbine stand upright. Once the base is in place, on land or sea, it's time to assemble the turbine tower. Manufactured from great sheets of steel that are curled into cylinders up to 8 meters in diameter and seam welded at the factory, tower sections arrive on site in sections to be stacked up. The tower is too big to be moved in one piece, either for ships at sea or conventional trucks, so modular on-site assembly of prefabbed elements is clearly the way to go. Craned into position and stacked one by one, the tower elevates the turbine fan up above the aerodynamic sweet spot of 30 meters above ground, where winds are usually less turbulent and more desirable from an energy harvesting standpoint. The tricky part here is aligning the different tower sections as they rise, with huge components in windy locations up against engineering tolerances of just a few millimeters. Atop the shaft sits the brains of the operation, also known as the nacelle. Crammed with upwards of 1,500 bespoke components, the nacelle houses the generator and drivetrain, inverters, sometimes a gearbox, as well as assorted monitoring, communications, and environmental maintenance gear. It's affixed to the tower via a sophisticated rotational yaw system, which allows the nacelle, and by extension the turbine blades, to turn and face the wind whenever it changes. The nacelle itself can be incredibly heavy, with one recent IEA offshore 15 megawatt model weighing in at over 800 tons. How on earth is that installed? With great difficulty. Mighty cranes, lift wires, and supporting tugger lines are part of the process. At sea, the impact of the wind on the dangling nacelle is surprisingly less of an issue than the oscillations of the tower itself, as it's battered by waves and currents below. Careful mathematical modeling is carried out before every installation, supported by clever civil engineering gadgets called tuned mass dampers, which go some way to help align vibrations between these two massive components units before mating. Of course, much of the nacelle is prefabbed before being shipped to site. Construction bosses need to make tough choices over what's efficient to make on site, against weight considerations and even simple limits on available deck space. Once in place and covered up with a weatherproof fiberglass gondola, the blades can now be attached to the hub. Engineers have come to favor a three-blade turbine format. Even numbers of blades cause problems with resonance, which lead to unseemly wobbles that in turn cause expensive and frustrating wear and tear. In theory, one blade works just fine, or nine blades, although they suffer from exciting-sounding vortex issues. Fundamentally, engineers are pragmatists and want an economical, scalable solution. For now at least, that's three blades. These blades, which nowadays can stretch over 100 meters long and be 4 meters around at the root, were once made of aluminium. But at current scales, that's far too heavy, so fiberglass is now in vogue. And in case you were thinking the job of winching up a 100 meter long, 55-ton fiberglass blade, a blade that's literally designed to catch the wind 150 meters in the air at sea, is easy, well, it's not easy. Each blade root is encircled by guide pins that marry up with flange holes in the hub. How do engineers compensate for the wobbly tower and motion-prone blade? Those passive-tuned mass dampers we mentioned earlier play something of a role. But in recent years, engineers have dreamed up two new techniques, both of which sound a bit like cheesy anime villains. Blade Dragon is a lifting yoke that attaches to the crane and holds the blade more firmly than a regular hook. The advantage here is it can be affixed to the hub at an assortment of inclined angles. Boom Lock is a smart system that sets out to eliminate, or at least compensate for, any lateral movement on the crane hook, so the blade stays steadier. These techniques make great economic sense, as they work at relatively high ambient wind speeds using fewer human operators, ultimately getting the installation done quicker and therefore cheaper. Indeed, modern wind farms can erect the tower, install the nacelle and the blades in a day, with just a little extra time for calibration of the blade's pitch angle and optimal yaw before connecting to the grid. As turbines get taller and more ambitious, construction obviously gets trickier. There's a limit to how tall a crane can usefully be, especially at sea, but some companies in the field, like Mamoet, have developed bold new solutions, spin-off technologies if you will. Take this WTA, or wind turbine assembly crane. Instead of being rooted to the ground or on a jacked-up boat, the WTA 250 uses temporary guide rails attached to the turbine tower itself. Capable of lifting a hefty 250 metric tons, it's superior because it has no footprint and can theoretically rise as high as the tower itself. Minimizing the role of humans in what is often a perilous working environment is another priority as the turbine construction field matures. Already, ultra-sophisticated mathematical models guide design and development of turbines and wind farms, and there's an increasing role for AI and software engineers to play in conceptualizing the next generation of taller, cheaper, and more efficient turbines. So the rewards are massive for any young nerds out there who wish to study the blade. What do you think? Are modern wind turbines ugly blots on the natural landscape, or inspiring monuments to human ingenuity and progress? Let us know in the comments, and don't forget to subscribe for more high-rolling tech content.